This is Something Wrong, a Lauren Lamb mystery, book 3, written by Kate Bold, read by Caroline. Prologue. She sprinted across the field, sobbing, not daring to turn around. Her dress billowed around her in the cool air, and she used one hand to lift it off the ground, fearing that she might stumble on the train as she ran across the field. The bells chimed behind her, and she wondered how long it would be before they realized she was gone. She thought she might have been better off trying to hide until someone else arrived so she could ask for help. Too late now. She had run, and now she had no choice but to keep running and hope she could escape before it was too late. Her eyes stung as her mascara ran into her eyes, driven there by the sweat that streaked down her forehead, even as tears ran down her cheeks. She had no idea how far she'd run or how long she'd been running. She'd read somewhere that the cathedral's bells could be heard up to 5 miles away, but she had no idea if that was true or not. She only knew that she needed to keep running. She looked over her shoulder and couldn't see anyone behind her. That was a mistake. She looked forward again, but not in time to see the hole in the ground. Her foot fell into the hole, and she fell forward with a cry, hitting the ground hard on her left shoulder. Pain jolted through her spine to her toes and up to her gums. She squeezed her eyes shut and gritted her teeth to stifle the cry that came to her lips. So what came out was a soft, keening wail instead of a scream. She held her injured shoulder to her chest with her other arm and rolled over onto her back, sobbing with the pain and fear. Don't stop, she thought, not here. She rolled to her knees and slowly got to her feet, then continued running. Her lungs burned, and the stitch in her side intensified until it was nearly as painful as her injured shoulder. Still, she kept running. She could still hear the wedding bells behind her. She wasn't far enough away. Not nearly. She was too disoriented to be fully aware of her surroundings. If she was, she would have realized that she was putting more and more distance between herself and civilization. More and more distance between herself and any chance of help. She was too frightened to think of that. All she could think about was getting away. She reached an old dirt road that led to a farmhouse in the distance and picked up the pace. She could reach it in a few minutes. The people there would help her. They had to. She began to sob again, a kernel of hope intensifying her desperation. Just a little farther, just a little more, and she would be safe. She stumbled again, but this time managed to keep her feet. She looked up, and when she did, she saw him standing in front of her, a crazed grin on his face. She screamed and veered to her left, reaching with her hands as though grabbing for an unseen hand. She didn't reach that hand, but another hand gripped her shoulder like a vice and yanked her back onto the road. She turned wild eyes up toward her attacker. He grinned at her and raised a long spike over his shoulder. It gleamed brightly in the moonlight. No! She shrieked. Please! The needle came down. She shrieked again. Then she fell silent. Chapter 1. Lauren stood in front of the altar and stared at the image of Christ on the cross. Jesus looked down on her, his face twisted in anguish, but his eyes filled with love. Pain and love, suffering and redemption, sin and forgiveness, the endless dichotomy of Christianity. We are all sinners, but we can all achieve righteousness through God. We all suffer, but Christ's love will redeem us. We are all fated to an eternity in hell, but should we submit our will to God, he will rescue us from that fate. She had once believed all of those things without question, accepting the words and assurances of her teachers. Then God had proven himself a liar, allowing his servants to suffer and die regardless of their worship of him. She had left the church and never looked back. Not until now. It wasn't God's love that brought her back. He still seemed to her a cruel God, one more desirous of the fear and servitude of humanity than the love and joy he promised. Still, if he was cruel, there were others far crueler. Novite perfide prodigus, non diu nunc prodigus. I know you, prodigus. Not long now, prodigus. Prodigus, Latin for prodigal. Both times she had encountered allegedly possessed women, first in Cepagati, while she and Father Emilio investigated the deaths of nuns, and second in New York, when they had investigated the murders of several clergy. They had called her that name. The reference was clear. She had left the church and left God. Now she was working for the church, and while she might not believe in God, she still served him. Not that she believed that, but that was what those who still believed would feel. So it didn't really mean anything that those two ill women had called her by that name.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.